Hi friends, welcome to the Ask tutorial. In this video, we will see in detail about hydrocephalus. From the name itself, we can come to a point that hydro water, cephalus it represents brain, so water on the brain. So water here it is represented as the cerebrospinal fluid. The cerebrospinal fluid is a colorless and clear body fluid, okay, which is secreted at the choroid plexus. The choroid plexus produce the CSF and within the ventricles. So from the ventricles it passes through the lateral ventricle, then to the third ventricle and to the fourth ventricle. So produced at choroid plexus, then it passes through the lateral ventricle, third ventricle, then fourth ventricle and to the basal cistern. And then it reaches the cerebral and spinal subarachnoid spaces. Then it is absorbed by the arachnoid villi and passes into venous channels. So in this diagram, can you see the choroid plexus where the CSF is produced, which is present inside the ventricles, passes from the lateral ventricle to the third ventricle, to the fourth ventricle and then to the basal cisterns, and then it reaches the cerebral and spinal subarachnoid spaces. The cerebrospinal fluid is produced at a rate of approximately 20 milliliter per hour, and hydrocephalus results from the imbalance between the production and absorption of the CSF. And there are two types of hydrocephalus, that is the communicating hydrocephalus and non-communicating hydrocephalus. Okay. Communicating hydrocephalus, there will be no blockage between the ventricles or the basal cisterns or the spinal subarachnoid spaces. There doesn't occur any blockage in these levels. Non-communicating hydrocephalus, there is a blockage at any level of the ventricular system. It can occur anywhere, but it occurs mainly at the foramina of Lasca and Magendine. The foramen Lasca is present in the inferior of the fourth ventricle, whereas the foramen Magendine is present in the which it links the fourth ventricle and the cistern magna. Hydrocephalus, the ventricle gets dilated above the level of block, okay, and the pressure increases, the CSF pressure will be increased. In cerebral atrophy, that is the hydrocephalus ex vacuo, the ventricles are dilated but the pressure will not be increased like in hydrocephalus. Hydrocephalus is either congenital or acquired. Congenital hydrocephalus results from the intrauterine infections like rubella and cytomegalovirus, and then toxoplasmosis, and all these infections cause inflammation to the ependymion of the ventricles and meninges or the basal cisterns. Ependymion is the neuroepithelial lining of the ventricles, so all these gets inflamed, the cisterns and the meninges get inflamed. So intracranial bleeding, intraventricular hemorrhages, and due to some congenital malformation which results in the blockage of the CSF fluid, and also the congenital tumors obstructing the CSF flows, okay. And the acquired hydrocephalus is caused by TB or chronic and pyogenic meningitis, and then post intraventricular hemorrhage and posterior fossa tumors like medulloblastoma and ependymoma, and also by the atriovenous malformations, intracranial hemorrhage, and also by ruptured aneurysm. So these are the causes of the hydrocephalus, the congenital and the acquired hydrocephalus. Features: enlarged head size, delayed closure of the fontanelle and the sutures. The associated symptoms, they will have headache, nausea and vomiting, and they will have the personality and behavior changes. And apathy means they will be like loss of interest in anything and with lack of enthusiasm and drowsiness. Then papilledema. Papilledema is the optic nerve becomes swollen due to the pressure buildup around it, and then the pyramidal tract sign, then cranial nerve palsies. The skull contour will be abnormal and the forehead will be prominent and the veins on the scalp becomes prominent and they are dilated. Okay, and they have a sunset sign, that is the sclera above the cornea will be visible. And congenital hydrocephalus, even the fetal life itself, they'll have a large head, so it is difficult during the labor. Accurate serial recording of the head circumference. During the first 3 months, there will be an increase of 1 centimeter every fortnight, and the sagittal and the coronal sutures will be separated for about 0.5 centimeters. And the diagnosis can be also done using the cranial ultrasound, then the CT scan and the MRI. So by this we can diagnose hydrocephalus. Treatment for the hydrocephalus, in case of a mild and slowly progressive hydrocephalus, then medications of acetazolamide and oral glycerols are given. But if it is very severe and rapid, the symptoms is progressive rapidly, then it is surgically treated using the ventricular atrial shunt and the ventricular peritoneal shunt. It drains the CSF directly into the circulations or into the peritoneal cavity. The shunt is of various varieties and they need to be kept for the entire life, and as the child grows it needs to be revised. We have completed about the hydrocephalus in detail. I hope you all would have understood it. Thank you for watching the video. If you like, hit on the like button and click the bell icon to get more videos and to subscribe to my channel.